event. Hello, very good evening, everyone. Welcome to our webinar. So today we will have a world-class scientist series two, and would like to say welcome to our honorable speaker, Professor Roy Goodacre from University of Liverpool. Hello, Roy.
Hi, all.
How is it going there in the UK?
Well, science is going well, but response to COVID is pretty bad.
Yes, I've seen it in your Twitters. In Indonesia also, we're still struggling to manage. But everything is quite stable in Japan right now. We have passed the second phase of the pandemic, and everything is slowly resuming back to normal here in Japan.
Yeah, we had over 500,000 cases in the last week.
Oh, that's a very big number of cases. I didn't think that it's still really like going up in the UK, but I hope everything will be normal soon and then you can resume your normal life back to the university. So before we start, I would like to just give a little bit of introduction, because we have many people who are just joining our webinar series, probably just this time, to attend your wonderful talk today, Roy, because we're very privileged to have you today. And before we start, I'm going to give a little bit of introduction about the Formind Institute. Perhaps everyone who's here and new to this webinar series need a little bit of introduction. So actually, this is a nonprofit organization established in Indonesia, and I was appointed as the general chair for this organization starting from last year. And we have people from industry and academia and also government involved in our events. So we have one of our BOD members, Ibu Feni Dwi Fani, who is also here today from ITB. And we have Ibu Neni Nur Aini from Biopharma, is a vaccine, one of the largest state-owned vaccine manufacturers from Indonesia, who's also a BOD member. We have Professor Ketut Wikantika and Dr. Muhammad Iqbal. And also we have two of our vice coordinators who are like our early career researchers who are now PhD students and master graduate. We have Sri and Marvin with us. So next slide, please. So as you know, I've been trying to advocate the science of metabolomics, and this is one of our events. Actually, before the pandemic, we started the Metabolomics Talk Indonesia in three different cities, Roy, in one of our prestigious universities. We have IPB University in December. We have in ITB Bandung, which is Bandung Institute of Technology, also in December. And then we had in Gajah Mada University. So these three are one of the top universities in Indonesia. And we had quite good attendance to introduce the science of metabolomics. And then the pandemic hits, and we were about to tour to many more universities to introduce about the science of metabolomics, but then we had to switch to more virtual or webinar series. So this is one of the series that we're organizing. Next slide, please. So these are our webinar series. We started at first with Indonesian speakers, and we had the talks all in Indonesian. We had like scientific writing, how to apply for scholarship, postgraduate fellowship. We also have about how to apply for patents and to understand more about patent rights and also about grant writing. Then these were really well attended. And we also had sessions with the government about COVID-19 vaccines. So this is like a discussion, open discussion involving the government, industry, and the academia working on COVID-19 vaccines. And that was really well attended. I think almost 1,000 people attend this vaccine. Then we held our first world-class scientist series, and this was in collaboration with the Ministry of Higher Research, Ministry of Research and Technology. and also IFOR, Indonesian International Scholars Association, with the Young Indonesian Young Scientist Forum. And you might see several familiar faces here. We have Jules also presenting about scientific writing, but more on the perspective of, from the writer perspective. And we also have Jessica, who's also a fellow board member, about how to establish ourselves in the field. And you know Professor Takanos as well. I think you know 3 out of 4. Yes. So this was really well attended, and it came at a really good time because that was when people started to work from home. And there were not so many webinars at the time. It was really successful that the ministry asked us to have the second series of world-class scientists with a more comprehensive, like, training based for Indonesian scientists. So this is where we are right now. The next, please. Other than that, we also had events for our younger participants, for example, like high school students. We have essay competitions to encourage more women in science. And then actually our Minister of Research and Science and Technology, Professor Bambang Brojonegoro, who's the top person in the ministry, he was in attendance and gave a talk also in one of our events, and Director General. So this is to promote more science, more girls in science. Then next, please. So these are our media portfolio about our aim to introduce more science to young female researchers in Indonesia and to increase the number. Next, please. So not only that, we also have business and leadership talks from industry professionals. We collaborate with Indonesian attache for education in different regions all over the world to attract people to study abroad and share with them the tips on how to get scholarships. So of course, we are very happy if we could have like a UK edition, for example, if anyone, like any scientist would like to be our speaker, we would be happy to have like different countries' perspective on the successful tips on how to get into prestigious universities in the UK, for example. Next, please. So this is the whole speakers lineup for the world-class scientists. We have different speakers talking about different topics, but there are 4 main themes that we would like to emphasize. Of course, the important part is about scientific writing, different aspects on scientific writing. We have also speakers from social science and humanities. And last week we had Krista presenting about grant proposal. And this week, of course, very, very important aspect about how to get published from you. And next week and the following week, we will have the industry academia partnership, as well as about startups, how to get funded if you would like to have like a spin-off company from your research. So these are our events, and yeah, we're doing many different things basically to increase the human capacity and human development of Indonesian researchers. And many of our events are also later on will be available for free through our YouTube channel. This one is recorded, but we have it unlisted for now because only registered participants can view, and actually it's selected. So we would have like active engagement. We intentionally want this kind of seminar to be a smaller number so that we will be able to interact more because it's more like a semi-training thing. Okay, so that is all a little bit of introduction about our activities and what we're passionate about, and hopefully our efforts will be useful to increase the capacity of Indonesian researchers in terms of academics and research, as well as community service. So without further ado, I would like to welcome Professor Roy Goodacre. And before we start your session, we will show to the audience a little bit about your biography. I think everyone here in attendance probably have already read about you, and many of our researchers know really well about your very long career and outstanding productivity in research. So I still remember, I think it was the first EMN workshop that we organized in Suruoka, and then you gave a talk in the EMN workshop. EMN is the Early Career Members Workshop. And I remember you gave a talk about a similar topic. And I was really impressed as a postdoc at the time. I was still very early on in my career. And your talk really inspired me. So actually, since the World Class Scientist Series 1, I've been wanting to invite you. And fortunately, you are available today. So it's been 6 months of waiting time to get you on board. So really, really happy and excited about that. So Roy is actually one of the founding fathers of metabolomics field, and so many publications have been cited, and you are, I think, one of the most productive researchers I've met, with a Scopus high index of 78, and you are also the editor-in-chief of a very high reputable journal that I always submit to, Metabolomics. And also Roy is an honorary fellow. So this is a lifetime award for your outstanding achievement in the field of metabolomics. And of course, as editor-in-chief and also a very prolific writer, I think you are a very good source of knowledge for us to learn on how to prepare for publication, not only for life science field, but I think the material that you share with us today can be applicable to many different kinds of researchers from different fields. So without further ado, I would like to play. You have a recorded video for us, right?
Yes. So for people to just explain, what I did is I put these on YouTube. And the reason for doing that is that I've also included closed captions. So, you know, there are subtitles there. They're in English, I'm afraid. I don't know how to do any translations.
That's fine.
But I thought that would be a nice way of kind of having them, just in case there's any failures this end on the internet. But then you've got them if you want to watch them again.
Yes, that will be wonderful. And actually, all of our participants here will get your material and also your recorded talk so that they could review it again later on, especially during writing. We should remember what Roy said in part eight, for example. So we're going to play your video, and then you're going to be staying with us. And then after each of the session, we will have a Q&A. So now we're going to start playing your recorded video. Okay, stay tuned, everyone.
Hi there, I'm Roy Goodacre. I'm a professor of biological chemistry in the Department of Biochemistry and Systems Biology in the Institute of Systems, Molecular and Integrative Biology in the University of Liverpool. And that unit is within the Faculty of Health and Life Sciences. I'm also a director of the Center for Metabolomics Research, and within that center, we develop mass spec methods, particularly GC, MS, and LC-MS, which we apply for human health and disease, microbial analysis with a focus on AMR, antimicrobial resistance, that is, and plant analysis. So we measure many different systems. Within the Center for Metabolomics Research, we also use Raman spectroscopy and infrared spectroscopy for measuring single cells and imaging tissues and cells. And we also have instruments that are portable, which we'd like to go on site and go into the field for analytical measurements. Outside of Liverpool, I started a journal in 2005 called Metabolomics, and I'm still the editor-in-chief there. And in the same year, I also helped found the Metabolomics Society, and was delighted this year to be voted back on to the board of directors. I'm also a director of the Metabolic Profiling Forum. So this video is really just an introduction to say who I am. The three video seminars that I'm going to cover are basically what constitutes a good paper, what are the essential elements within that. Then there'll be one on ethics within science and scientific publication. And then wearing an editor's hat, I'll tell you what happens to your paper when it's been sent off and hits an editor's office. I hope you enjoy these. So in this video, we're going to go through what are the essential elements in a good paper. And hopefully by the end of this video, you'll have an idea as to what a paper contains, how it is read, and therefore where you should concentrate on. Now you can see in this particular area, a little bit of music. And so every now and again, just as a kind of aid of memoir, I'll introduce some music. So if you hear a good paper, this is the sort of thing you might think. That was Little Richard singing Good Golly Miss Molly, something exciting, and that's how we should feel about good papers. And of course, when we think about papers, the first thing we have to think about is maybe where we're going to send them and where we read papers. So this is a meme that's been made popular over the last couple of years, and you know, so the reader here is thinking whether they should read that paper in Nature or Cell, and they make that decision. Similarly, as a writer or an author, you might then decide whether you're going to send your biochemistry paper to EMBO Journal or to Current Biology. And if you're an analytical chemist, then you make a choice as to whether you think analytical chemistry is a, in quote, sexy place to send your paper, or whether you prefer to send it to analysts. And we could have lots of these kind of memes. But we all make choices as to where we submit papers and where which ones we tend to read. Now, as scientists, we often have opinions, and these opinions are often quite diametrically opposed. Okay, so an author would come along, and obviously, you know, when you're an author, you think, well, this is my best work ever. I'm really, really proud of this. But obviously, that gets read and commented on, and so you have readers. And they may be going, well, actually, I don't believe a word of this. And someone else might say, yeah, I agree, until I've seen, let's say, the work validated and, you know, some explanation given. And then someone else might say, well, actually, yes, they do make some good points. And this is a thing of scientists. We're trained to think that our work is very good and probably be a little bit blinkered and to think that everyone else's work is not so good. And so basically, what you have are two tribes. Now, clearly, unlike Frankie Goes to Hollywood there, who was singing Two Tribes, scientists don't go to war. Okay, we're somewhat more objective than that. But you can see there's a sort of yin and yang, if you like, between authors and readers. So let's have a think about it. So what makes a good paper? Well, the first thing, of course, is it does have to be scientifically sound. The paper has to be carefully constructed. It has to be focused. And of course, it has to be interesting. And you could say that of most papers. But for me, what I think makes a good paper is one that's actually motivated enough to make me learn more about the subject. So a little bit like this Kinks song, where the paper, you know, really gets me. So I should be motivated there to learn more about the subject. And of course, one of the best papers is one that you actually finish reading. Tonight, I'm gonna have myself a good time. And like Queen there, you really don't want to be stopped when you're reading a really good paper. And in fact, I remember years ago traveling back home on a train, and I got so engrossed in a paper that I looked up halfway through it and realized I just missed my train stop. So I had to get off at the next junction, or not next junction, off at the next station and return. So those are things that I think make a good paper. They're scientifically sound, but they're motivated that you want to learn more, and actually you finish reading the paper. The question, I guess, is also, is where should you send your paper? Okay. And the essential elements there are that your paper should contain succinct material to be repeatable by another lab, and it should be put in context with the literature. Okay. And those are elements of all papers. But the answer to the questions like where should you send it is that it should be relevant, if you like, to the aims and scope of the journal. So it should be clearly written for that journal. And when you write that paper, it is important that you read the instructions to authors. Okay. As an editor, and I'll go through in a future video what happens when editors read papers, but you can see papers that have been formatted not for your journal, and that is not a very sensible thing. And of course, you then need to think about page charges and open access charges, and that's a thing that as an author you do have to think about. Obviously, there can be a charge. Actually, it's not funny, but that was Money, Money, Money by ABBA. And it's an important aspect that you should be aware of open access charges. So at the moment, Nature are thinking about charging $9,000 US dollars for publishing a paper, which is clearly a very, very expensive charge. Okay, so that's where you should send your paper. Obviously, you need to focus the paper to that particular journal. Before I go on about more about what constitutes a good paper, I think it's worth just thinking about how most people read a paper. Okay, there's an awful lot of information in the world now, and many thousands, tens of thousands of papers are published per day. Okay. And so it's very difficult for everyone to read everything. So what typically happens is when someone gets a paper, they'll open it, read the abstract, get a feel for whether they think that sounds interesting. Obviously, the title should be enticing. They then look at the figures and tables and they'll read the conclusions. And if they're still interested, then they tend to read the rest of the paper. Okay. So very few times do people pick up a paper and read it from the first word to the last word. Okay. They do it in this order. They read the abstract, they look at the conclusions, and they look at the figures and tables. And so the figures and tables here are very, very important. And there is an adage that basically says, you know, a figure is worth a thousand words. And in fact, most papers, you should be able to get 95% of the story from the abstract and the figures and tables. Okay, so the figures are very, very important. And they must be self-contained. So figure legends, for example, should be quite comprehensive. Okay, they should be understood without having to read the main text. And the reason that most people spend a lot of time writing their figure legends carefully is because people will look at the abstract, will look at the conclusions, and then just the figures and tables. So if they can't understand a figure from the legend, they're probably unlikely to go any further. Okay. So if we look at the structure of a primary paper, so I'm thinking here about research papers rather than reviews, with the caveat, of course, that a review can synthesize knowledge and so therefore is obviously research. But if we think about primary research here, new work that's being conducted in a laboratory, then as you look at the paper, obviously you've got the authors, that's who did the work. You've got the title, should be descriptive with as few words as possible. Okay, and should be interesting, should have a hook in that title. The abstract really is a summary of why, how, and what. And so the introduction is the why, its importance, why the work is important, and it should set the scene adequately. Materials and methods are then the how, and that will include things like ethics, statistics, and chemical identification. Okay. And the results and discussions are then what was found, those will be those figures and tables, but what it means, okay, the meaning of those results. And then, of course, you have references, you'll have acknowledgements and remember that, others who have helped, funders. And then supplementary information is becoming more and more popular where you might have additional methods, you may have additional figures and tables and data. Now, I guess, you know, wearing an editor's hat for metabolomics, then what is actually important is chemical identification. And particularly, you know, when you are measuring things with mass spectrometry or NMR spectroscopy, it's important to be able to say what the metabolite is. So here's a rather naff neem. So Harry Kane is an English footballer, played for England in the last World Cup. And really, when you're talking about chemistry, you want to know whether you've got single bonds, an ane, an ene, an ine, you know, whether you've got an alcohol, so Harry Canol, Harry Canamane, and Harry Canoate. Okay, so it's important that we understand sort of chemical identification because in that field, the results and discussion are based on the ability to identify something and then work out what its biochemistry, what its biochemistry is. Okay, now if we think a little bit more about the production author or production order of a paper, people will not write the paper in the order that we've just gone through. Okay, the first thing you do is you decide on the figures and tables. So you decide on what scientifically you want to show someone. Okay, and you agree that as a set of authors. So you write the tables, you make the figures, okay, and you decide at that point what goes in the main paper and then what is supplementary that backs things up. Okay, and supplementary information can be important. It should be additional work that strengthens the work. Okay, it's still perfectly okay to have in the text data not shown and not show the data. Okay. So that's the first thing that is done. The second, because it's easy, you know, you did the work, you know what the materials and methods are, so you write that, okay? And that gives you a kind of little boost, in fact, in the fact that that aspect of the paper means that you've now got a few pages done, so you're already towards finishing the paper, okay? The third thing is really then to decide what materials and methods might go in the supplementary information as well as well as some data. What you then do is you write the results and discussion. So you've come up with what the figures and tables are going to be, you're going to come up with the materials and methods, you now explain them. So you write what this actually means. And you do that before you write the introduction, because the introduction will set the scene for what the results and discussion and conclusions may contain. By that time, you've written most of the text, obviously you have the references, so you check they're formatted, you make sure they're formatted appropriately for the journal. You then write the abstract, okay? You then agree on who the authors are, okay? You have a discussion about that and you agree the order, you agree the order of them. And most laboratories will basically have the person who did most of the work as the first author and the person who supervised the work as the last author. And basically, the first author did most of the work, the second author, the second most, etc. So you agree that, okay? At that time, you also then write the title so that it's reflective of the work. And it's important, of course, to acknowledge others that may have helped, who may have given you plasmids, let's say, if you were doing work in that area, or funders. Okay. So that's the general structure of a paper. Now, in terms of course, how big a paper can be, then we need to consider that as well. This is an article that was written in 1995 by Royce Murray, who at that time was the editor-in-chief of Analytical Chemistry. And Analytical Chemistry has it moderates the size of the papers, and most papers in that journal are up to 7 pages. And the idea here is that if you write things in a very, very concise way, then you're more likely to make the work more impactful. So if you can spend half a page writing something that someone else might have waffled on about in 2 pages, you're more likely to get read and therefore more likely to have an impact in that particular field. Now, of course, that comes with a challenge, is that science is very data rich, and we want to tell everyone what we've done. And particularly if you're doing analytical measurements, then the devil really is in the detail. You really need to understand and tell someone precisely what you have done. So again, there's a balance that's had here between having something that's too short and incomplete versus something that's too complete and therefore too long. And this is where, you know, things like supplementary information are really useful to put extended information about the paper. So let's have a look at the essential elements of materials and methods. Okay. The first thing is that materials and methods must allow someone in another laboratory to repeat the work. This is in terms of samples, their preparation, and their analysis, whether it's chemical analysis or biochemical analysis, okay? Data analysis and statistics are essential, and clearly that someone has been able to articulate this correctly, what the data are, what the analysis has been done, what the pre-processing, and what the pre-treatment is. In some journals, for example, use a statistician to check the statistics, okay? And most journals check that the data are available. And when we think about data that are short and fat, and we'll come on to this in the next video when we talk about ethics, it's important that data are made available because public money has been spent on generating them, okay? So most journals now expect data to be made publicly available. And it is, of course, important that the information you give there is clear and can be clearly understood. Okay, so you must eschew obfuscation, which of course in itself are two horrible words that basically mean adopt clarity and be understood. So that's really the essential elements of the materials and methods. It is absolutely essential that someone else can repeat the work, okay, and understand what you have done. If we again go to the essential elements of the results and discussion, then clearly it must have statements about principal findings, what you found. You should be balanced. So you should talk about strengths and weaknesses of the study, okay? And those strengths and weaknesses should be in relation to the literature. So you should be able to cite papers that back up what you're talking about, okay? You must be able to let the reader understand the meaning of the study, okay? And if it's a biochemical type of work, possible mechanisms and implications of the work, as well as suggesting future work to address limitations. And don't be frightened of including those in a paper. It does not mean referees will turn around and say, well, this work is limited because the author said so, so therefore they should be going out and doing that work. Okay. So you should address limitations, talk about strengths and weaknesses within the results of discussion. And of course, then wrap everything up with this overall conclusion, which, as I've said, is important because that's how people read the paper. Okay, they will look at the last few paragraphs in the results of discussion and see what the authors have concluded there. It's important that when you're doing this and you're generating results and discussion, you don't oversell your work. Okay, so I've read many papers where you read the abstract and the introductions and the aims, and you get this sort of beautiful horse who you think might win, a horse race. But the reality is, when you read more, okay, that the results and discussion really are lacking in detail. So don't oversell your work. And another version of this is, you know, the abstract might be very hunky, look very interesting, and the introduction also is selling the work. But when you get to the results and discussion, you're really quite disappointed in the analysis. So please don't oversell your work. And this is why it's important to write the results before you write the introduction and then finish off with the abstract. Okay, so now you're ready to submit. Okay, and there are some final checks. Make sure you give all authors the opportunity to read the final version of the paper. Okay, this is important. It helps missing off an author in a laboratory. It can also create lab frictions if you forget an author. So it's important to give all authors an opportunity. And in fact, if you're in a research group, to let your research group read the paper as an internal review. And if the authorship changes after revision, then journals want to know why. And in fact, all authors must sign off on that. Okay. And remember, of course, to acknowledge your funders. So if you're at this point, you're like this person. It might seem crazy what I'm about to say. Sometimes it's here, you can take a break. I'm a hot air balloon, I could go to space. With the air, like I don't care, baby, by the way. So that was Pharrell Williams, who was certainly happy. And I think every paper, when I've submitted it, I felt happy that that work has been done. Okay, and then I look forward to having it peer reviewed and the comments come back. The last thing, of course, is that it is important to give your paper a final good proofread. Okay. Proofreading can avoid embarrassments. And so this is a paper. It's published 6 years ago, and it's a study looking at single wall copper nanotubes, okay? And it makes a rather stupid abbreviation. So best not to do that. Writing is a long process, and this is a nice cartoon that's this man is saying, I don't understand it. No matter how much I drink coffee, play on my phone, refresh my email, look up things online, go to the kitchen for snacks, message my friends, scroll through Twitter, and play with the cats. I still can't get any writing done. And that's probably particularly poignant at the moment, in the fact that given that it's 2020, most people are locked down at home. And so they are spending more time in their houses. Okay. And those of you who have met me have seen that I have a rather large figure. So I quite like the kitchen, and I quite like going for snacks. So getting yourself in the right frame of mind is important to get writing done. Okay. And it is a long process. And this is a nice, nice little cartoon going through, you know, the time spent on a paper. This is from Errant Science. And it, you know, the top is really how you think things. You design experiments, you then collect data, you write up a paper, you upload data if it's a data driven study. And then you wait for the reply and you do corrections. The reality, and I'll let you read the bottom offline, is a little bit different. So I hope you found that useful. I've set the scene in terms of what a good paper contains. I've also told you a little bit about you know, how people write papers. So good luck with your scientific writing.
Okay, that's really wonderful talk. I think it's so entertaining and I really enjoyed every minute of it. So really, really great job on the presentation. And I think everyone here, look at everybody's happy faces. It's Saturday evening in Indonesia and also in Japan, and we're not sleepy at all. We truly enjoyed your talk, Roy. So now we're going to open the session for question and answer. So you could type in chat or you could just turn on your microphone. If you have any questions, please raise your hand. Okay, so Ibu Tri Rini Nuringtias, also a metabolomics researcher. Please, Ibu, would you like to ask directly to Roy? So you can now unmute. Yes, please.
Thank you very much, Ibu Sastia. Thank you very much, Roy. It's very entertaining and very interesting. I find it's very helpful for me. That I think I still have wrong way to write a paper, because sometimes we are directly goes to intro and then goes to, it's not like the way you do. So my question is, when you say that the introduction should be at least at the fifth. So why it's like that? Can you explain it more for us? Why it's after you give the, okay, figure and table, sometimes we did it already. And then, but then normally we go directly to the intro or something like that. So could you please explain more? Yeah.
Yes, of course. Yeah. And thanks for the kind words about the talk. So basically, when you write the results and discussion, you're telling a story. Okay. You're saying what the work entails and what you found. And really, that's why, you know, you've said yourself that you you write the figures and tables first. And the reason is the figures and tables set the scene of the paper. So the best thing to do is then to write what that means. And when you're writing what that means, you will come to some conclusions. And those conclusions you might then want to back up with some data that's there in the literature. So you do that. You put your work in context with the literature. When you then write the introduction, you know, you then seed those thoughts to the reader that they're going to get this in the results and discussion. So you're already telling someone a little bit about why that work is important. So, for example, you wouldn't write, if this is a very, very bad example, right? But if you were writing about, let's say, plant metabolomics, you wouldn't describe absolutely everything that's ever been done in a plant metabolomics study if you were then going to look at Arabidopsis and look at day-night cycles. So you would focus your introduction on those aspects. Now, you probably think you can do that anyway without writing the results and discussion. But the whole point is to try to have some literature in the introduction that's getting people already on your mindset and already thinking about what you're going to be then discussing. Is that helpful?
Okay, thank you. Yeah, thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Ibu, for your question. So we open for another question. So if anyone would like to ask. Okay, so if we have a question from the chat, would you like to ask directly, Marininta, or should I read it out for you? So it's when your paper is rejected from a journal, what aspects should I think to make a decision whether I should resubmit or change to other journal, probably to a lower ranked journal?
So if you're still watching in about 60 minutes time, I'll cover that.
Okay, great. So we're going to cover it.
That will be what happens to your paper and then how you respond to comments.
Okay, thank you so much, Roy. So Mercy, you have a question and you can unmute your, if you would like to ask directly, please.
Okay, thank you so much. Hello, Roy.
Hi.
I have a question. I am from Indonesia. So some of our problem is in developing country like Indonesia, sometimes that we have a limitation of the research. So what do you think? Is it better to postpone our publication when we think that we still incomplete in the result? So because of the limitation of the research, so it is better to just postpone our publication or just write it with the existing data? So what do you think? Thank you so much.
Yeah, that's a nice question. Thank you. I think obviously you have to balance that. No work is ever complete. Okay, that doesn't matter where you live, where you work in the world. Most work is evolutionary in nature. Okay. Those kind of revolutionary things tend to be what get people Nobel Prizes. And I think they're going to be very, very rare for all of us. Sorry, there may be people out there that are lined up. But so basically, you know, if you feel that your study would be better if you waited a few more years to generate data, then, you know, you make that decision. The only issue with that is, of course, someone else might be able to get there first. So what you do in the limitations aspect of the paper is you explain that maybe this is limited because of, let's say, sample size effects, if it's that way. So you say, well, the work is preliminary and it needs to be backed up in further studies. So you could make those kinds of claims. The other, I guess, is that if you're worried about someone else doing your work first, okay, because obviously that's a lot of the time people are concerned about that, then depending on your study area, then you can put your preprint online as well. So you can use things like BioArchive, ChemArchive, or MedArchive, and I think I mentioned those in one of these in one of the next videos. And basically what that allows you to do is it gives you a date stamp when you've done the work. So then let's say you send your work to a paper into a journal, and let's say it gets rejected because someone says, well, actually, you do need to know more, you do need to have more work. If someone else then does the work, you can at least challenge that because you have the date at which you first reported that work on BioArchive. Okay. And by the way, for people, the putting data information on BioArchive and the other archive engines does not mean that you're self-plagiarizing, okay? Journals are quite happy that authors are doing that. It's a difficult scenario sometimes. You know, so some areas there's, you know, at the moment we have a lot of papers coming out in diagnostics in COVID, you know, whether it's metabolomics or other methods and stuff like that. And actually, if you look at some of the papers that are coming out, even of very, very good labs, they're not very good. And so a lot of people think it's best to be first rather than best to be right. Okay. So you know, it's really a balance. Okay.
Okay, thank you so much, Roy. I think this is a kind of confusion usually when we know that probably this needs to get out there, but then we know that some work needs to be done. So this dilemma always happens. Yeah. And actually, we still have one more question, but due to the time constraint, we have to move on to the second part of the talk. So if you don't mind, Ms. Shifa Fauzia, to please type your question so that we can answer it later, or perhaps Roy can also type his answer in the chat. So thank you so much for a wonderful question and answer session for the first part. So now I would like to move to the second session. So the second session is about the ethics with science and publication. So this is something that I think is crucial and very, very important, but not a lot of people talk about this actually, but it gets more and more increasingly important to be aware of these issues. So without further ado, we would like to play the second session. And Roy, before we start your video, would you like to give an opening or something about this issue? No? Okay. So let's hear Roy's second part of the talk.
Hello, in this video, we're going to discuss ethics and particular ethics within science and also within publications. So if we look up the definition of ethics in the Oxford English Dictionary, we get the following definition that says ethics is to do with moral principles that govern a person's behavior or the conducting of an activity. And if we look up the synonyms of ethics, then what we find a lot is that morality features greatly, rights and wrongs features, as do rules of conduct and standards of behavior. So ethics is very important within research, and so we should give it some care and attention. If we think about research and ethics, then really academic research is built on trust. We trust our colleagues, we trust our peers, that what they report in the literature, what they publish, what they give presentations in seminars, is correct. And here's Bart saying, trust me, I'd never lie to you. And many of you have seen The Simpsons and you know that that's the last thing you should do. And basically, research and ethics should be and is indeed internally policed. And that policed aspect is largely through a peer review process, and we'll cover the peer review process in the next video. Let's have a look at what happens when trust is broken, okay? And this can affect academics, it can affect industrialists, and it can also affect stakeholders. The problem is the research may be flawed, okay, if it's not done correctly, not done ethically, and therefore there is a loss of integrity. And that loss of integrity may be to the researcher themselves. Of course, it could be to the whole research group. We'll give examples of that later. Or perhaps even the whole research area. And it can lose that academic street cred and possibly their job as well. Now, if we think about ethics within a whole research area, there was a case some years ago, where someone published in 2002 a series of papers in The Lancet, and this was looking at SELDI, it's the Surface Enhanced Laser Desorption Ionization, and the lead author there was Petra Cohen, and he published this paper in 2002 that showed that you could separate out women who had ovarian cancer with control group of women who didn't have ovarian cancer. And this worked so well that this work was repeated several times. Now, the good thing is that Petra Cohen made his data available. And 2 years later, Bagley and others published a paper in Bioinformatics showing that actually most of the signal that allowed the separation was in the noise region of the spectra. And it was basically artifacts for sample processing. That's a kind of cautionary tale. The issue here was that SELDI, which basically was spotting a sample onto a onto a moldy target plate that was modified in some way took off, and a lot of clinicians used this method. After Bagley's paper was published in 2004, Saldi basically disappeared. So in this case, the trust was really broken and the whole research area was compromised. So that's a kind of cautionary tale, if you like. Well, when trust is broken, then we also have to think about funders. These could be research councils in countries or in regional areas, and also the public purse. So funders could pull the money, they could reclaim funds, and that can have personal implications on the scientist that's been unethical. And of course, it could cease research in that area. And for Saldi, you know, that has wider implications. That method may be very useful, but people will not look at it now as a method. So if you think about public values and trust, then these are just three examples I'm going to give. So in 2006, you know, Korean Ethics Committee condemned stem cell research because basically too many cells were analyzed, and it coincided with a retraction of a paper. And so this was really a serious ethical problem, where donated human eggs were, if you like, abused. A few years ago in the UK, in fact, 7 years ago now, public trust was really damaged for supermarkets that ended up being found that they had somehow were selling beef burgers that contained horse meat. And there the reputational damage was great. There was no issue in terms of health and safety. No one died because of this, but the reputational damage was huge. And then back to research, there's a recent commentary in Nature that showed that actually you could engineer yeast to produce opiates. And then the thought process was, well, if you then ingested these, you know, maybe they wouldn't be good for you and things like that. And really, actually, the research was not flawed, but the public's perception of that could be seen to be flawed. And this paper basically shows that, for example, the whole pathway from glucose to codeine or morphine could be reconstructed in a single strain. And so therefore you can see that, you know, the public's perception of an organism being able to brew, you know, a drug that is banned would be very bad. Similarly, you know, public trust in supermarkets because of unethical practices, not by the supermarkets, but by other people, was bad. And similarly, in terms of stem cell research, which is a highly regulated area. So let's have a look at a little bit more about ethics on the public, because most of us who work in universities and industry are reportable to the public. And so there's a responsible code of science that needs to be done. So this is doing good science, okay? This is reporting good science. And also, because the public purse is often funding this, then science should be done for social benefit. In other words, science doing good for a population or for a country. And science is also a social enterprise here, and it's supported by society for the benefit of society. And so research councils that award grants are basically using public purse money to support society. Another area we have to think about in terms of ethics in the public is outreach and public engagement. And it's important to manage public expectations. So the yeast producing opiates is an ideal example as to why that could be twisted and not understood. So it's essential to inform, listen, and engage with the public, and to treat the public with respect and to allow them to understand the reasons why a particular experiment is done. And of course, as well as the public, are the stakeholders, people who are involved in that research, whether they're direct or otherwise. And so there has been, and this is just one example of the RRI initiative, okay, which is Responsible Research and Innovation. And the RRI concept here is from Engineering and Physical Sciences Research Council website. There are similar on the EU Horizon 2020 and other research councils. And basically, the key elements here are to anticipate, reflect, engage, and act. So anticipate is to look at how what you do could lead to impacts, okay? Doesn't seek to predict what those impacts are, but what the potential implications are. And then the idea is, once you've done that, is you reflect on what the purposes or motivations of that particular research work are. You engage, usually with others, not just within your own research team, and you engage and reflect, okay? And then you act to make sure that the research direction that is being undertaken and the innovation process itself is as ethical as possible. And most scientists do this, okay? They anticipate, they reflect, they engage with the work they're doing, and they act if they see that things are not going in a particular direction. So at this point, we've not actually talked much about the types of misconduct that could occur within a research program. The first is obviously to consider human and animal studies and the violation of ethical standards within those studies. And there is lots of ethics around sampling humans and sampling animals, okay? And in 1964, the Declaration of Helsinki was published, and this is basically describes ethical principles for medical research involving humans. And this is just a quote from that that says, medical research is subject to ethical standards that promote and ensure respect for all human subjects and protect their health and rights. So this would be telling someone that the sample you're going to take, what you're going to do with it, and conducting research that is not violating human rights. And so many journals, for example, require several statements when you submit a paper, and in fact these statements are often found within a paper. And these are things in terms of human rights, ethical approval of a study, the welfare of animals, as well as informed consent. And so people sign up to those, and there's a sort of code of conduct that one expects to follow. If we look at others, then the types of misconduct that might occur is data, in terms of falsification of data or fabrication of data. And this is a particular favorite of mine. It was published in Organometallics, that basically was left in the supporting information that the editor, that the reviewers, and indeed the authors missed. Someone had written in the document that, Emma, please insert NMR data here. Where are they? And for this compound, just make up elemental analysis. So that was clearly sort of fabrication of data. That paper has had amendments to it. I find that when you think about research ethics, particularly in terms of fabrication and falsification of data, that a really good website to go to is Retraction Watch. And this is updated daily and has lists of papers where they've either been retracted by the journal itself, the publisher, or by the authors. So this is a case that's 5 years old now, but it's quite interesting because basically this was an apology because the papers published in Nature, papers published in Cell, contained the same information, and not only that, that a postdoc in the lab had faked 74 panels, figures, tables in these three papers. And you can imagine that there is deep regret here by the scientists, but obviously the reputational damage is great for that. And so that's an example of fabrication. Okay. The other is one of plagiarism of others, where you copy other people's work, and of self-plagiarism. And another example from Retraction Watch here is a geological study. It was four papers that were published, and the first paper, that was published still stands, but the others basically copied exactly the same data and repeated the findings, but also self-plagiarized in a really quite large way. And so one by one, these papers have now been removed. And of course, self-plagiarism is a difficult thing, because in materials and methods, it's probably more acceptable to have words that are quite similar as opposed to things in results and discussion, because the results and discussion should really be quite different. And some journals, so for example, Springer uses Authenticate, and basically when a paper is submitted for publication, it goes through some software that's a little bit like the academic version of Turnitin, and produces reports of text that's been copied and where it's been copied from. So these are checked by editors, obviously, for those of you who may be worried that if you put your paper onto, BioArchive or ChemArchive or MedArchive, these are obviously they do get spotted in this, but obviously the editors and reviewers adjust their views because they know that you're just publishing your paper on those archives to make sure that you get that date stamp first of when the work has been done. Okay, there are a few other types of misconduct. The other is salamiing, is basically taking one study and cutting it into four or five to try and get four or five papers out of the work. I mean, that's not misconduct as such. I mean, it's a sort of dubious practice, and it's much better. And probably for the authors and for the study, more impactful if that work was published at the same time. And the other, of course, is reporting. Is either reporting something incorrectly, reporting it incompletely, or being selective. And for the omics methods, this is very important. Biology, life sciences, is in a very data-rich environment, and most of the time when people generate data, they're on few subjects with many different characteristics, whether this is transcripts, proteins, or metabolites. And those data are what are called short and fat. So you basically have a lot of characters on very, very few subjects. And this was quite nicely highlighted in terms of this editorial by George Poster on Bring On the Biomarkers. And this was published in Nature a few years ago now, that showed that at that time, so 9 years ago, there were claims of 150,000 biomarkers, but only 100 of those were estimated to be clinically useful. And a lot of this is because of selectivity actually in the data analysis as well as the reporting. And this was picked up by my colleagues, Dave Broadhurst and Doug Cowell. They published a nice paper in Metabolomics talking about statistical strategies for avoiding false discoveries, in particular focused on metabolomics, but all of the omics have this particular issue. And that issue was further highlighted 3 years ago by John Ioannidis in this paper on a manifesto for reproducible science. And quite worryingly, they reported that 85% of biomedical research, this was a poll of people, said that research efforts were wasted. And 90% of respondents in a survey in Nature said there really was a reproducibility crisis. And part of that is shown here. And this is a kind of cycle in terms of, generate hypothesis, design, study, conduct, analyze, interpret, publish the next study, et cetera, et cetera. And people are having a publication bias because they might want to go in a particular direction. Interpreting and analyzing data, when you have very, very large numbers of characters and very few samples, then there's a practice of p-hacking, where you deliberately look for metabolites, proteins, transcripts that might say something useful about your data, or in fact going back to the data, okay, once you've p-hacked and done so-called harking, which is hypothesizing after the results are known, so that you kind of, you bias this particular issue. And when I talked about short fat data, a few samples, lots of characters, this is basically a problem and can lead to low statistical power within a particular area. The other interesting thing here is that the respondents in Nature said there really was a reproducibility crisis, and the journals that tend to not be quite so robust in this area are the so-called glory journals, so the journals with very high impact factors. And the reason for this was quite nicely articulated by Arto Castavel in this paper in MBio, where he described the problem with specialist journals versus general publications. And basically, if you look at general publications, so things like Nature and Cell, they have very high impact factors because they're general. But the person, the gatekeeper, the editor who is looking at those papers actually has a very low knowledge that's specialist for a specialist paper that's sent to a general journal. And basically what you find is that specialist papers into specialist journals generally fare better because they are, the gatekeeper here is an editor who is specialized in this area. And it's quite interesting that if you look at specialist journals and you look at the impact factor and you look at the H index of the editor, the impact factor tends to be low for the journal but high for the editor, and vice versa. So the impact factor for Nature, for example, is high, but the editor's there tends to be very low. And so this kind of slightly drives some of this problem in reproducibility bias. Let's go back to types of one misconduct. The other is potentially an authorship for authors, and all should have contributed, and they all should have agreed to what is reported. And in fact, when people submit papers, they tend to, there's a checkbox that says the corresponding author confirms that all authors have agreed to this particular piece of work. And sometimes the authorship changes. Okay, after review, there may be changes in authorship. Someone may now have contributed if an extra experiment is done. And if that authorship list changes, either in order or the addition of new people, then that has to be agreed by all authors and signed off back to the journal. So that's gone through some of the sorts of types of misconduct, and I hope you've found that useful. The other thing, of course, is that sometimes even the best get it wrong. And at the beginning of this year, Professor Frances Arnold retracted a paper that she published because of the fact that looking at enzymatic synthesis of beta lactams, this was not reproducible. But she was honest, she came out and she retracted this. And so honesty, you know, really in scientific publication and scientific ethics is the best policy. So I'll finish just with telling you about the main parts of ethics, that we have to be responsible for the conduction of that science. We have to do science for social benefit. Science is a social enterprise, okay? It's paid for by society for the benefit of society. And obviously in ethics, one needs to think about the outreach and public engagement to steer the public to understand why you may have done that particular experiment. And so ethics is bound up in accountability, principles, integrity, and values. And I'll finish there and thank you for listening this far. I hope you found this useful.
Thank you very much, Roy. It's indeed a very important source of material that we all need to be aware of as a scientist. I'm not sure, because I don't have a career in Indonesia, but at least in Japan, all researchers must complete ethics course, we have to do like self-learning, learn from video, and then we have to pass. And that is a lot of modules to learn. But if we don't pass this with acceptable grades, we are not allowed to apply for funding. So only those who complete this ethics course can apply for public funding in Japan. So I am just wondering, how is it in Indonesia or in the UK about the level of scrutiny on how much scientists have to be aware of this issue? Would you like to comment on that, Roy, in the UK?
Yeah, so in the UK, it's kind of assumed that you get ethics at your undergraduate, but also that there are courses at PhD level, and then it's obviously reiterated by your supervisors and postdocs. When you submit a grant for publication, it gets reviewed by a panel, and it gets reviewed usually by 3, 4, 5, maybe even 7 or 8 people. And there's always specific questions asked about ethics. And if you're working on animals or humans, then you have to, you know, say what the ethical nature of the work is, how many animals you're going to use, and also whether the work has gone through ethical approval. And basically, if someone, let's say, starts taking samples from people without permission and they get found, they lose their job instantly. So, I mean, it is taken very, very seriously. I've recently moved to Liverpool, and we had there was an issue quite a long time ago in Alderhay Hospital where samples from children were being kept without parents' permission. And that caused a huge problem and actually completely rewrote all the ethical standards in the UK. So, yeah, we've been bitten, should we say, in the UK. That's been highlighted. And so people are very, very, you know, very, very clear. So every sample should come with informed consent.
Yes.
And if someone is unable to give consent, then a responsible adult for that person would give consent. So if an example is, let's say someone is intubated, so they're on a coma, they're being held on life support, and someone's interested in finding a biomarker as to whether you know, they'll recover quickly or not recover at all. Then you take a sample and you measure it. You get permission from the guardian, next of kin. But if that person then comes round and says, I don't want my sample used, it would then get removed from the study and all the data would be destroyed. So there's quite a lot. There's quite a lot in place.
Perhaps anyone would like to add how it is in Indonesia. See, perhaps some addition. Is it within the curriculum or is it a part of the training for researchers? Perhaps Mamersi, if you could give a comment.
Yes, talking about ethics, I think same in the UK that in the bachelor degree there is a curriculum, part of curriculum which include ethics in writing, in general writing. But sometimes probably due to the less practice for the students, so in the last years, sometimes students, many students do plagiarism. So if I can I ask a question?
Yes, please.
Yeah, because many of our students sometimes do plagiarism. So could you please share a simple trick to avoid plagiarism, particularly which is detected by like a Turnitin or other
So to avoid it is really education. So I have, I guess, more experience in my previous university in Manchester. And I'm not saying this to imply that Manchester has any worse plagiarism for students than Liverpool is. I just don't know the Liverpool situation. But I used to sit on a panel that would investigate malpractice for students. And so it would really be at the Turnitin stage, whether there was plagiarism or potentially collusion, where, you know, individual work has been copied and put in by several people. So really, it comes down to educating people early on, and then if it gets found out, you obviously have a chat with that person, and if they show remorse, then you say, "Don't do it again," because the second strike is really, you know, very serious, potentially expulsion from the university, and you allow that person to rework their work, but you cap the, you know, you cap the percentage mark, so that if they pass it, they could only get a pass grade. So that basically tells them that, you know, they've been a little bit naughty there. But it is really just it is an education thing. You know, some cultures think that copying someone else is flattering. Okay, and that's not necessarily the case. So it's basically education.
Yes. So instilling the values of like honesty and integrity probably from very early age is very important.
Yeah.
Because sometimes at the university stage, it's quite difficult. So there's a question about self-citation. I think it's probably, she's confused about self-citation and self-plagiarism. Perhaps you could explain a little bit more about that.
Yeah, so self-plagiarism is if you just copy text without modifying it at all from one of your papers and put it into another one. That's self-plagiarism. Self-citation is absolutely fine. If you've done a piece of, so let's say you've worked in a particular research area and this is your fifth paper explaining a new aspect of that particular mechanism, then you're going to cite yourself, and that's absolutely understandable. In reviews, it isn't, okay? So if you write a review, you should make sure that it's balanced and that you include other authors in that. Otherwise, you're effectively writing a kind of monologue. you're writing your what we call a doctor of science in the UK, where you put all your papers together and get another degree if you're so minded. But that's a sort of difference. So self-citation is absolutely fine, but it should be balanced. If there are other papers in that area, then they should also be included. And you should then be careful that you don't say all these other papers are rubbish and I'm wonderful. Because reviewers don't tend to like that, by the way.
Yes, there are a lot of cases of really, really serious misconduct. Like, I think fabrication or falsification of data is particularly very, very serious case. And sometimes the person who's doing the work, even the supervisor has no idea about it, because like the falsification or fabrication of data is done really well. So like, yeah, different labels of the samples are being used and then to reflect the kind of data that is not supposed to be the case, like the case of Riken several years back, Obokata case was also a really serious case. So I think very, very important is for all of the researchers to be aware of this issue. And thank you so much, Roy, for letting us know the very basic fundamentals and make everyone aware on the do's and don'ts in science. And I think nowadays, most of the reputable journals include the ethical guidelines very clearly. And then we have to state like the informed consent and then the ethical issue, especially when we use samples that are like vertebrates or higher animals, things like that. So yes, I learned a lot also by publishing in your journal. Okay, so I think we don't have any more question for this part, and I would like to wrap up the second session and move on to the third session of this talk. So the next session is about publishing your work, the role of editors and the review process. So this is related to one of the questions asked by Burininta in the chat, and now we will play the part C of today's seminar.
Hello, so this is the third video in the scientific publication series that I've generated. And this one is on publishing your work, and in particular focusing on the role of editors and the review process. Like the first lecture on generating your paper, there will be some musical interludes, if you like. I gave a version of this talk with my good friend and colleague, Professor Jules Griffin from Imperial College London at the beginning of this year, when we were in Toulouse at the Metabolic Profiling Forum meeting there. So let's have a look at the review process and give you an idea as to what the overall process is that happens when your paper is submitted before we go into specific details. So the first thing is that the submission is received by the office and it undergoes some checks, and I'll go through what those are in a little bit. And then it's assigned to an editor. That editor looks at the paper and decides whether it's worthy of consideration. In other words, is it within the scope of that journal? Is it scientifically worthy? And if it isn't, then they reject that and inform the authors, and obviously the authors are unhappy. At that stage, they may offer a transfer of that paper to another journal. So in other words, if a journal is more general, they may suggest a specialist journal that that work would be better suited. And of course, they may well decide that paper is worthy of consideration and then we'll send it out to review. And they'll typically send it out for two or three reviewers. Revisions will be looked at from those reviewers, and that will be collated so that a decision can be made. And if at that stage the editor can't make a decision because they have diametrically opposed views, in other words, one person thinks the work is great and another thinks the work is not so great, they will often send it out for a third adjudicatory review. And then a decision can be made, whether that's accept, revise with minor or major corrections, or to reject the work. And obviously, if it's rejected, the authors are informed and they're upset. And they may be offered a transfer. Okay. If a revision is needed, then the authors are asked to do that, and I'll come on to how you should write your revision back to an editor, to a journal. Okay. And then a revision is made, and that goes for editorial assessment. Okay. And they, again, can make the decision to accept, revise, or reject the paper. If it's minor or major revisions, then often the editor can make those decisions themselves, okay? Sometimes for large major revisions, then the editor will send it back out for re-review to the original reviewers, okay? If the paper is accepted, then they inform the authors, and they're really quite happy about that, obviously. The galleys are generated. This is where the manuscript is turned into the finished article. The authors then check that. At the same time, the editor can also check that the galley has been generated well. At that stage, it's important to point out that after an author has signed off, okay, the paper now gets its DOI, its digital object identifier, and cannot be changed. Okay, so if there are changes after the authors have meant to have checked the paper, then those go as errata back into the journal. And then the work is published, and the authors and an editor actually are happy when they see the paper online. And indeed, sometimes some of those publications are still printed. Okay, so let's have a look at who's involved. Well, there's an editorial managing system. Everything now is run online. Okay, so there's someone who overviews that particular process, and they look at the paper before it goes to the editor, and I'll detail what they do in a little bit. There's then the editors. They're usually academics, and they often act as the gatekeepers. Okay, so they're allowing your paper to come through the gate to go in to be reviewed. And there are generally three types of editors in the system. There's an editor-in-chief, Okay, there may be a reviews editor who specifically looks at reviews, and there's also an editorial advisory board, and the EAB are used often to review papers. There's then the reviewers on themselves, and I'll discuss them in more detail later. It's a production editor who basically turns the manuscript into the paper, so they're the copy editing that particular piece of work. And then finally, there's a publishing editor, and they oversee the whole of the publication process and make sure that this is done as robustly as possible. So let's have a look at the role of the editorial manager. This is when your paper first is submitted, and this piece of music is really quite. So that was Stand and Deliver by Adam and the Ants. And that's effectively what you're doing at this point. You have delivered your paper. You're standing by that particular piece of work. And what the editorial manager does after you've delivered that, okay, is they check the paper for formatting, and in particular that the paper complies with the rules of the journal. So the references are in the right format, that if the abstract is structured, that it is structured in a particular way. If that journal requires results and discussion to be separate sections, that they appear as separate sections and not as a combined section. So that's one of the things they check. They check for copyright forms, that they're there and that they're correct. They check that there are ethical statements if they are needed. Okay, and we covered ethics in the last video. And they also look at conflicts of interest. And they make sure the data are available if that is the journal policy, that the data should be available before the paper is published. They also check to make sure that certain conventions are observed, so things like IUPAC for naming structure on chemicals. They check for plagiarism, and in the last video I went through that and the fact that some journals have authentication software that they run. And they also confirm that the authors are indeed the authors, okay? And it's important that that you don't make up email addresses for authors, because this can really bog down the review process. So that's the role of the editorial manager. Then they're not necessarily academic, they're just checking that that these things have been done correctly. The paper then goes to the editor, and the role of the editor is to see and decide whether that paper is appropriate, whether it's in scope, okay, or whether it's not in scope. Some journals look to see whether they think the work is impactful or not. Is it evolutionary in nature, or is it revolutionary in nature? And some journals, the editor or the editorial team would assess the paper for sort of general interest. And here we're talking about papers like Nature and Cell, which are very high impact, and they want to know whether everyone will be interested in that paper or whether it's a specialist. Okay. Unfortunately, for those specialist, non-specialist journals, then desk rejections are really common for these so-called glory journals. And ironically, they seem to do this on a Friday, so that you can be nice and upset for the weekend. Okay. So presuming your paper has gone through the editor and they're happy and they've sent it out, let's have a look at editors and the review process. Okay, so they oversee the review process via solicitation of impartial reviews. Okay, so here we've got, you know, the author is getting mauled there by the reviewer who looks like a bull. Okay, and you've probably also seen this meme where it doesn't matter who you are, if you're the reviewer, you're the one who has a cranium that looks a little bit like an ape rather than a human. But the editor really oversees this process and looks for impartiality in the review process. Okay. Now, you could ask the question, how do the editors choose the reviewers? Well, most journals have an editorial advisory board, okay, and they will use those people, they're experts in particular areas, and they're often used more for adjudicatory reviews. And these are, when I said, when you get diametrically opposed reviews, when someone likes a paper but the other reviewer doesn't like it, okay? And so you ask someone who's impartial, they're on your EAB, so they should be impartial to have an opinion. There's also then a database that the journal has, and some editors, by the way, score their reviewers. So if they think they're very good, they give them a high score, and if they think they're misbehaving, let's say, in other words, they're being overcritical or there's a conflict of interest, then they will score them down and not use them for future future reviews. And of course, you as an author can suggest people to review your work, but please don't put your best friend down there, or someone you've published with, or someone you collaborate with. It's very easy for an editor to see that in the review process, okay? And then that reviewer, basically, their opinion is not really counted towards the review of that paper. And you can, of course, deselect reviewers if you feel that they are conflicted in some way, okay? And you should provide the editor with a suggested reviewers and also reviewers that you don't want that paper to go to. So if you're a reviewer, then we should think about the role of a reviewer. And this is Springer's view of reviewers. I take this as an example because I'm an editor-in-chief of Metabolomics, which is a Springer journal. And peer reviewers do several things, okay? They safeguard the relevance of the work for the journal, okay? The editor also does that, okay? They advise the authors about important earlier work that needs to be taken into account. They check the methods, they check the statistics, sometimes they check the English as well, and they verify whether conclusions are supported by the data. So those are more general. What they're not meant to do as a reviewer is constantly suggest other experiments that should be done. That's an unreasonable thing for a reviewer to be done. They're not an author of the paper, okay? They are critiquing what has been submitted for publication. And it's worth noting that the final decision as to whether an article is accepted or rejected is always down to the editor. So there will be scenarios where a reviewer has rejected a piece of work, but it will still get accepted because the editor has looked at those comments and balanced them with the comments from other reviewers. Now, who are the reviewers? Well, they're just like me and you. They're human and they have feelings, okay? They're also doing this voluntary, okay? They're doing it for the good of science, to keep, if you like, that wheel of science going round and round. What are the rewards, you might ask? Well, some may be a warm, fuzzy feeling. In other words, you're helping the system by reviewing reviewing that paper and thereby expecting someone to review your work as well when you put it in there. Some journals have adopted Publons, which is a system where you can register yourself and then it tells people how you've reviewed and where you've reviewed. Some journals at the end of the year will publish a list of reviewers and thank them. So you get acknowledgement in that particular way. And then some journals may also give you electronic vouchers to access papers or books, or give you reduction in author publication charges. Those last two are, shall we say, less common than most. Okay. And let's have a look at you as a reviewer, particularly when to review. Well, you should only really review a paper if you have the appropriate experience, okay, and you can actually do it in the time allocated. So, you know, it may be flattering to be asked to review a paper, but if it's outside of your area of expertise, then tell the editor that this is not within your scope, okay, and also tell the editor if you need more time. You can ask for more. Most editors will adjust the reviewing date for you to come back. And the worst thing you can do as a reviewer is ignore those invites, okay? Because the whole system just grinds to a halt because the editorial managing system will wait a few days before you then get uninvited. And you can imagine that the more and more people who do that on the paper, the lengthier and lengthier the time for an editor to make a decision. And if it is your first review, then seek help from a senior colleague. Okay, it's perfectly acceptable for PhD students who have published papers to be reviewing papers. They've had their papers reviewed, and they should therefore also get advice from their principal investigator on how to do that. And of course, you can also ask for feedback from the journal. If you feel you have a conflict, then do not review the paper. It's very clear, often for editors to see this. And as I said, if you can't do the review, tell the editor quickly. And it's nice to suggest other people who might be able to do the work. And the last thing on this, you might say, well, how much should you review? I mean, we are all pushed for time, okay? And it's some years ago, I had a postdoc of mine come into my office and said, oh, I've just been asked to review, you know, my second paper in the last month. You know, should I do it, Roy? And I said to him, well, how many papers did you publish last year? And he said, well, I published three papers. And I said, well, according to those statistics, you should be reviewing between 6 and 9 papers per year. Okay, so that's how much you should review. Every paper you will have reviewed is reviewed by at least 2 people. So you should think about that as a sort of useful yardstick. And then when the reviewers come in, the editor, if you like, makes an executive decision, whether it's accept, reject, or revise. And they basically facilitate communication between the reviewers and the authors. Okay, they don't send emails to them. They do it through the editorial managing system, where they're basically facilitating that communication, particularly for revisions. And as I said before, sometimes you need an adjudicatory review or reviewers. So you go out to someone else who is an expert in that area, and it's usually a member of the editorial advisory board. And sometimes this goes round more than once. Okay, so you'll get a second or even third round of revisions. And then you get your paper accepted and you feel like this song from Queen.
I've paid my dues time after time. I've done my sentence but committed no crime. And bad mistakes
that's nice. If you're very happy, then you know your paper's been accepted and you do feel like a champion there, sung by the Queen. Of course, your paper may be rejected, and like this Rolling Stones song, you basically ain't going to get no satisfaction. And then, of course, the other is revision. And as I've said, this can be a simple revision, but it can also take quite a long time.
The long and winding road. Seen that road before.
So yes, that's Long and Winding Road by the Beatles, and of course I have to have a Beatles song in here because I work at the University of Liverpool. But yes, sometimes the revisions can be long and winding. I've recently had a paper accepted and published at the beginning of last year in Nature Communications. And that took 21 months to be reviewed. And that's a really, really long time. Okay. let's assume that you've been asked for revisions. What's next? What should you do? Okay, the first thing is you write a letter, okay, to the editor, as well as revising your manuscript, and you thank them. You thank the editor, and you thank the reviewer, and you even thank reviewer two, if reviewer two is the person who's not been very nice, okay? The reason for that is they may well see your comments, okay? And what you should do is you provide a point-by-point response that has helped the editor and reviewers scan through the responses. So remember that this whole process takes time. So the reviewer has read the paper once already, and really, they probably don't want to read the whole thing again. They just want to see what you've done in terms of done those modifications, okay? So this is why a point-by-point response is really necessary in the letter that you write to the editor. And also, you should make it clear in the manuscript by using perhaps a different color on the font where you have made changes, okay? Where those revisions have been made. Should you act on every single comment? Well, no, of course not. Okay, some comments will be unreasonable. And you can say, well, actually, yes, I can appreciate this comment, but I don't think I need to address this if it is a suggestion of another experiment that is going to take far too much time. And in fact, you know, it may well be that a PhD student has finished their particular work, okay? And most reasonable editors will take this into account. They will not expect every single comment to be taken on board, but they will expect most, okay? And most of them are not kind of really huge things that are going to take 12 months to address. So that's the revision. Write a point-by-point letter, make it clear in the manuscript where those changes have been made, and then the second review usually is much, much quicker because that person can scan the paper and see where those changes have been made. Unfortunately, if your paper is rejected, then it can be frustrating, okay? But you should think about this in a positive way because the reviewers may well have suggested ways to improve the study, and you could make those improvements and you could submit the work again, either to another journal, if it's maybe a little bit more specialist, okay, or back to the same journal. But if you do that, I would strongly suggest that you ask the editor first so they can see whether that work has changed sufficiently for them to look at it again. Because if they've made a decision to reject it, they have to overturn that decision when the work comes back in, okay? And if you really think things have gone unfair, then you can, of course, by all means appeal to the editor, okay? And the editor will look at those appeals and will write back to you and make a decision. But of course, choose your battles carefully. It's pointless appealing on absolutely everything that is ever sent in. Okay, so I know rejection can often be an upsetting thing. The thing you've got to think about at the end is that it will be worth it. I'm going to play a song here by Daft Punk called "Get Lucky." It's one of my favourite songs. Okay, and I've also done a screen grab of pictures that people have put in their messages on Twitter when their papers have been accepted. And you can see a great deal of joy in these messages. And even though I'm quite long in the tooth now, I still get a great deal of pleasure when any of my papers get accepted.
To get lucky, we're up all night to get lucky, we're up all night to get lucky.
Thanks for listening.
Oh my God, I can't stop laughing towards the end. It's such good humor, Roy. Thank you so much for a wonderful, wonderful talk. I think you grab all the essence of like the publishing part and what happens with our paper and all of the components. And a lot of our attendees here are in fact senior researchers and lecturers, and they're also they are in the editorial board or they're running their own journal in Indonesia. And I think it's really useful the way you express everything, not only for the authors, but also from the journal management point of view. And thank you so much for having me on board as one of the advisory board for Metabolomics Journal from last year. It's really a huge honor when I received that invitation from you. So we are open for questions. I'm sure lots of people here would like to ask questions. So if anyone have a question from the audience, you're welcome to ask directly, or you can type your question.
Or we could sing.
Or we can sing, yes. Actually, okay, so while waiting for the question to come, I think everyone is really excited already everything is really clear, but I have a question actually, Roy, because I have two questions. The first one is, it's relevant to all of the other parts, but I have a collaboration with an industry and they gave us two sets of strains. But due to the company policy, and probably they have like copyrights or patents or something. So it's like, because they're a very big company and they don't want to tell us in detail about what those strains are.
Yeah.
They just give us bits and pieces. Even us as collaborators don't know in detail how they constructed the strains and everything, but they just told us enough information that this strain produces this and this. And then they ask us to do a metabolome analysis, and then they would like us to report together about the findings. And I think for the scientific merit, it's a lot, because like this is a very important strain. But then as a scientist, usually we have to detail the information and the genetic construct so that other people will know exactly what is. So what do you think about this kind of like, we want to publish it, the parts that scientific communities need to know, but at the same time, the industry needs to protect some of the.
Yeah, sure. Yeah, so I guess there's two answers to the question. The first is, you know, whether the industrial partner has patented the work, in which case that acts as a publication and they're protected anyway. That's the easy answer. The other is that you can anonymize things. So, I almost blush when I think it was 1994, I published a paper with an industrial body that basically explained that we were using microbe M, and it was producing product P, and our paper was all to do with predicting the amount of P that was being generated. So we didn't tell people even what the strain, what the species was, or what the product was. And I think, you know, if you write in the letter to the editor that this is, you know, you are constrained, but actually the findings are really quite nice for, you know, how you might optimize that process using metabolomics, I think that's absolutely fine. Okay. I think people are reasonable, okay? You know, if you're protecting something for the industry, but you still want to publish things on the side, then that's one way of dealing with that.
Yes, that's very reassuring to hear. Thank you so much. I've been wanting to ask the question, and this is a good chance, actually. Do we have a question from the audience?
I want to ask a question.
Yes, please.
In the first part, Roy, you say that as an author, usually we see on the abstract conclusion, figures, and tables. So is it the same point of view between authors and editor at first glance? Thank you.
Yes, absolutely. Absolutely. So when I get a paper through, the first thing I do as an editor is I read the abstract. I have a very quick look at the figures and tables. And then if I see something that worries me in the figures and tables, I'll look at that in more detail. If at that point I think it's fine, it then goes out for review. And a reviewer, by the way, will not read a paper that way. They will read it from first word to, well, not quite first word to last word, but they will read the vast majority of that paper.
Okay, thank you very much. And we have another question from Ibu Nuning, please.
Yes, thank you very much for your time. I'd like to ask, as an editor, will you also consider about the authors? I mean, when you read, whether this is author is known or it's you never heard it or something like that, will you consider it? And then my second question is, if we are serve as a reviewers and then we found that seems like the data is, or the way they do, the way they conduct the research is not really well. So should we mention it to the author or to the editor? Thank you.
Yeah, so those are good questions. So the first thing is, personally, I don't look at who the paper's from. There are papers from good names that are rubbish and vice versa. And if anyone feels that they feel there may still be a problem, most journals will allow you to submit your paper anonymously. So Metabolomics does this, for example. So the author, so the editor does obviously, but the reviewer does not see who the authors are. So you can kind of do it in that way. Now, when you're reviewing a paper, if you think that the work is not being done to a high standard, you should definitely tell the editor and the authors. And the authors should then be able to say, well, oh, sorry, I missed out this key bit of information that I should have explained. And then that might make it actually better. So I, for example, get a lot of papers into Metabolomics where people don't describe at all how the quality control on an experiment was done or how metabolites were identified. And reviewers pick up on that and they say, well, can we have some more details? You know, this author has said these 10 compounds are important, but we have no idea as to the level of their confidence. And basically most authors will write back and say, yeah, sorry, I overlooked that particular aspect. It's for these reasons. And that then just improves the study. So if you see flaws in experiments, point them out, because they may not actually be flawed. It may just be bad communication, which is good for you to, you know, good for you to point out. If there are then serious flaws that don't get resolved, then the editor will look at those, and they may ask the author, for example, to insert words like preliminary in the title of the paper, mm-hmm. or they will just reject it and say, you often reject a paper, but you might suggest, well, actually, you know, there's some merit in this, and if you do the experiment properly, and it'll take you some time, please come back to us. So you basically reject the paper, but you suggest, you say, well, would like to look at the paper again in the future.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you so much. So we have a next question from Ms. Shifa Fauzia. Would you like to ask a question? Yes, please.
Okay, thank you for a chance. Thank you for your talk, Professor. It's so interesting. I learned a lot during this time, and I have submit a paper several months ago, and there are five reviewers there, and four of them giving a positive comment, that means suggest to publish, but one is just giving a negative comment that rejected. But the editor giving an opportunity to revise the paper. So we revise based on reviewer comments. And after revise, the reviewer giving comment back and stayed from five reviewer, four giving a positive answer and one giving a negative answer. The final decision is still rejected from editor. So even though the reviewer giving a positive answer, the final decision is still on editor, right? this is when I feel it's unfair, like the editor just ignore others, leave others comments. Thank you, Professor.
Yes, yeah, so that, I mean, that can be very frustrating.
Yes.
And I mean, you can appeal to the editor and ask them, you know, why they have basically ignored 80% of the review where things have been positive. Okay, and you can kind of try and insist that they come back to you. You know, I'm not saying this is the case, but there may be a scenario where that reviewer picked up something that's absolutely key that the editor agreed with. But you would only find that out if you go back to the editor and ask them.
Yeah, but the same thing happened to me 2 years back, actually. A very good journal. And three of the reviewers actually didn't say anything about rejecting the papers, just giving very constructive comments. But the editor rejected nevertheless.
It's unfair.
So that happens.
It does. And it's probably worth saying that it's... you know, it might well be that you submit it in again and you get a different set of reviewers and they have a different opinion. Okay, and that's something that you should be aware of, that, you know, the editor choose reviewers and they're not going to choose the same reviewers all the time. So there is a slightly, I hate to use the word stochastic, but there's a slight random element sometimes. It's probably more so with, you know, higher impact journals. Because they're more, let's say, generalized, and therefore the editor, you know, can be swayed by someone who says, well, I know a lot about this area and I think this is wrong, just because the editor knows no better.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you so much. So we have a next question from Iburetno Astuti. Would you like to ask your question or should I read it out for you? I think it's related to the people. I think she's probably running a journal that is quite new and it's probably not yet indexed. Yeah. And it's very hard for a new journal to get submissions in the beginning. So because usually people would like to publish their work in a more established journal. So the first few years of managing the journal is very difficult, I think.
Oh yeah, it was for Metabolomics.
Yes, and could you share with us what happens in the beginning? Like probably you have to be proactive in contacting your colleagues.
Very, very proactive. So I don't think I actually got on the telephone to phone my friends in the metabolomics area, but the first three issues, I probably commissioned all of the papers.
Oh,
and actually for the first two issues, I was the only person who reviewed the papers so that we could get the things going. And it will take a few years. So the Scopus Index, I can't remember if it comes in after 3 years of regular publication. In order to get onto PubMed, so Metabolomics is now on PubMed, but it took three goes. And they only accept about 13% of the journals that apply to go onto their indexing system. The way of getting around that is to make your whole journal open access and then they automatically appear on there. But to start a new journal in a new area, yes, it, you know, you have to unfortunately work hard and you have to use your friends, okay?
In the beginning, yeah, because beginning. It will take years for you to get indexed. And then up until that time, it's very difficult to convince people to submit if they...
But you also have an editorial board and if they're giving talks, they should have the new journal as one of their slides. And so that's what I did. I made a slide of the journal and I sent it round to the editorial advisory board. And then you'd say to the EAB, if you have one, you know, you have to be proactive. You have to email at least five people to try to get papers so that you get that traction at the start.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you so much. And it's very, very useful. And Ibu Anna, Ibu Nofriana Sumarti also have a question. Sometimes we have journals who don't respond or take so long to get the first decision and then authors are sometimes like in a limbo. Ibu Ana, would you like to comment on that later on? Perhaps Roy, you can answer first.
Yeah, so it obviously does happen. So I get contacted by authors who would like their paper back sooner. And quite often I go into the editorial managing system and I will see that the paper's been sent out to 7 or 8 people. So, you know, when I was saying if you're asked to review and you can't do it, say so immediately. Because what happens is I might select, so you select 2 people to review the paper normally, but you might in the background have another 3 lined up. And the system is that if someone doesn't do anything, the paper sits there for 7 days, even though there are reminders sent. And then after 7 days, it goes to the next author, reviewer. And if they don't do anything for 7 days, it goes to the next one. So you can see that it can cascade down. And the worst type of reviewer is someone who says they'll do it and then they don't deliver it, because they get 3 weeks and then it will extend to 4 weeks. And so the whole system can grind up. So quite often that's a reason for papers being in the system for too long. But again, you can write to the editor and you can say, you know, what's happening. I do this regularly, by the way. and you will get a response. You should get a response. I mean, I recently had some correspondence which was unidirectional between me and a Nature journal, and the editor never got back to me. And I've let as many people know that I will not publish in that journal again. Neither will I review for it, because that's just rude. So, you know, if papers are taking too long, then have a word. But there's usually a way. It is not the case that the editor has just not done anything. It's often slowness of the process. And also, if the work is like really, really specialized, then it can be quite hard to get reviews. So if you have a paper that you find is taking too long, write to the editor and say, you know, it's obviously taking some time. You know, it'd be nice if this could be sped up. Here's a list of reviewers who could also review this work if you need them. And then that will be very, very beneficial.
To offer a list of reviewers.
Yeah.
Also, yeah, I think probably most of the time now, especially with COVID-19, for some reason, I feel like the time to get the first decision in all of the papers I submit gets longer. I think probably the pandemic really has an impact.
Yeah, definitely.
As well on the reviewer availability. Somehow we're working from home, but then we're busier.
And the other thing, of course, is, you know, if a paper has got a split decision on it and you have to go to an adjudicatory review, that can obviously slow things down.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And some reviews, you know, I get back and they just go, yeah, this is okay, I'll accept the work, with no details. And then you look and you find out that actually that's someone the author suggested. So you go, well, they're clearly conflicted. So you just discount that review. And if it's taken that person a few weeks to do, then obviously that just adds extra time.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, it's also, you know, impartiality in the system is important.
Yes, I actually have a quite unusual experience several months back where the review came really positive the first round. And then I submitted a response, and one reviewer commented on the number of sample, like the sample size, and suggest that I change the way I write the paper so that it will show, is more reflective of the work, instead of making it like a very comprehensive, I could just make it like more specific and focus on. So the suggestion was not to actually increase the sample size if it's difficult, but rather to change the title or like the general conclusion. And then that's how I responded. And then the second review would make a more comment on that aspect. And then it was dwelt upon more detailed by the same reviewer. And then the second reviewer who didn't make any comment about that, then make a comment about that in the second round of review. And then the third round of review, finally, the other person says, okay, that's fine. just change this part, this part, this part. So there's three rounds of review. But then the editor at the end said that it's going to be rejected, and then just add the samples and then resubmit. So I was like, what happened? If this was an issue from the beginning, the editor should have said something from the early on. And I was just wondering how this kind of case can happen. Did the editor probably did not see the progress? Yes. Or?
Yeah, it's called lazy editor.
Yeah, I suspect. So I made a very big claim and said that that's not very professional, and this kind of issue should have been dealt with in the first round of review, and then not like point out different things in different rounds, because that is really time consuming and frustrating for
the author. It is. I mean, there are scenarios. I'm not saying this is what happened, but I've had papers where, you know, the paper comes back and both reviewers say, yeah, there's some problem here. I don't understand this particular aspect, and they ask the authors to improve their manuscript, so they improve it. And then it comes back and they say, now that I understand what they've done, I'm really worried that there's a problem here. So just because the paper gets reviewed and gets a revision doesn't mean it will get accepted. Because often, I know it's really frustrating, and I've had it in my own papers where the second or third review is now starting to pull out things that were never mentioned in the first review. But it's possibly because the explanations have improved as to what was done in the study. I think in one of my papers where it was the fourth revision, I wrote to the editor saying, if you could please let me have the reviewer's name, I'd like to include them as an author on the paper, because they've changed this paper so much from what it was originally submitted.
To become better.
Yeah. And that's, as I said, that's where some things are unreasonable. If you're asked to do experiments that are going to take, you know, a very long time. So the paper I mentioned in Nature Communications, we were asked to validate the study. So we went out and we'd already measured 1,200 people. So we validated the study with a further 700 people. And in fact, that was when it went into Nature Medicine. And they said, no, it's not been validated in an independent cohort. And this was an aging population. So the study had taken 15 years to set up, and it probably cost for all the collection of all the other data, because it was a European study, about 5 million euros. And then they expected us to go to another population and validate the study.
It's not unreasonable.
Yeah, it's completely unreasonable. But the editor was just, well, I personally will not send a paper with that editor being an editor of that journal again, because if they're just going to be swayed by a reviewer who was clearly conflicted, in some way, I think that's just unreasonable. But there you go.
So that's why it took like 24 months, you mentioned. Oh, yeah. 21 months.
Yeah, 21 months. Yeah.
Okay.
But I know it is very frustrating. As I said, you should, you know, if you feel strong about that sort of scenario, you should definitely write to the editor and appeal. And if you don't get joy there, if there's an editor above them, because sometimes there are section editors, then you write to the overall editor as well.
I did write to the editor in chief, and then write to the editorial office, and then they mentioned that, yeah, they apologized for the oversight in the first one, and then they realized that the process is not perfect, and probably the reviewers spot the things that were probably not spotted in the first round, and that happens, but they still very much welcome for me to resubmit with the necessary or but then I resubmitted to another journal, and then it got accepted immediately with minor revision.
Yeah.
So actually in the level of the journal, the two journals that I submitted was quite similar. So yeah, it's just a matter of, you know, sometimes we don't get lucky also. Yeah. And there's also a question from Buratno Astuti about her being very active to review. So even give a certificate as an outstanding reviewer, but that journal also many times reject her article. So it's really sad.
Yeah, that's tough. I actually don't know what the advice is. I think just keep trying. I have colleagues in other areas that have said, you know, that when that kind of thing happens, they would just put that journal on their banned list. It means they won't submit to it, nor would they review for it.
So stop reviewing for the journal.
Well, you know, we can go, you know, we can go back to the songs and sing, I ain't getting no satisfaction, you know. And it is unfair if you're reviewing constantly for one journal and they're not looking at your own work. So, I have a few that I don't review for now.
Okay, so there's another question from Muririnta. So please, if you would like to ask question,
you're welcome. Yes, thank you very much. So I was wondering, so how to suggest like our PI or supervisor to suggest about there's something like their ambitions that want to submit in that particular journal, and they probably their obsession is like if they get rejected and then they will just resubmit again. So that's kind of like postponing our publications because I don't know. So how could you suggest, Professor, in how to deal with this kind of relationship between me as a student and the supervisor thing?
Yeah, I think other than sitting down with a cup of coffee or maybe a socially distanced cup of coffee and saying, you know, if a paper you're writing isn't going to get published at all, then you're losing that potential impact in your work. And by impact, so you know, the currency for most scientists are their papers. And if you're not publishing papers, then if you go for a job, that seemed to be not so good. So you could point that out to them. And you could say, well, perhaps, you know, if it's been rejected, then it's not of the quality of that journal. And you just go to the, you go to the next one on the list. So, yeah, you know, because we submit things. We try sometimes to go to high impact journals.
Mm-hmm.
And you just, you know, some days I've submitted a paper on Monday into a Nature journal. If it's still not rejected on Friday, I think it's actually been sent out for review. But it might be because the editor's been away for a few days. But it is a difficult one. I think, you know, you need to explain to your supervisor that, you know, that this is going to be detrimental for your career.
Quite,
I mean, it's a tough conversation, I'm afraid.
Yeah, I already suggested that. So it keeps delaying my publication process, and it's better to choose another journal, I guess. But it seems like, I don't know. Yeah.
So the other way of maybe dealing with it is to insist on the work going into bioarchive or something like that as well, because then it does have its DOI, it is seen. And at least then, if you're, if you need evidence of that paper having been submitted, there is evidence because it's on a repository, it's on a database. And some people will actually review that paper and give suggestions. So more and more of my colleagues in Liverpool I see are putting papers on bioarchive. And that, as I said, that gives them that date stamp, but it also means that that work is then publicly available, but not published in a traditional peer-reviewed journal.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Okay, so really, really excellent session of question and answers. And I think we have probably accepted many questions already in a little bit longer than our usual session. But because I'm sure this is such a valuable time with you, Roy, to be conversing with you directly and get a lot of wisdom. So probably many questions will still come. And if you still have some questions that are not answered, you could send us an email at formindinstitute40@gmail.com. And then probably we could compile that and send it to Roy, and he could probably respond to that whenever you're free, Roy, of course, if you don't mind. Yeah. And I think I would like to close the second and the third question and answer session and invite everyone to turn on their camera to let's take a picture, group picture together, because this is really, really a rare opportunity for us to be here with you, Roy. And I think our admin staff are probably ready to take group pictures. Yes, Kay, have your big smile ready. Okay. Marvin, see ya?
Okay.
Okay, so I'm gonna count up to three. Yes, okay, 1, 2, 3. All right, the second frame, please. 1, 2, 3. Okay, one more. 1, 2, 3. Very good. Thank you so much. Udah ya, Marvin, ya?
Yep, Bu.
Okay, so Roy, we would like to end this by, maybe you can keep your camera on. Maybe we can give a big round of applause to Roy. Thank you so much, Roy, for a very, very entertaining and very informative and excellent lectures. I think this is one of the best trainings I've ever attended. It's really nice to finally have you on board, and it's truly worth the wait of 6 months to have you speak for us. And when we want to close, before we close, we have a very special thing made for you, actually customized. And this is as a token of our appreciation. Maybe our admin can play what we have made for you, Roy. So this is you, a caricature of you. And this is in the background of Kelimutu Lake in East Nusa Tenggara, Indonesia. It's a very beautiful place. And I hope one day, have you ever been to Indonesia?
No, I haven't. No.
Oh, okay. But you've been to Singapore many times. So hopefully next time when you go to Indonesia, go to Singapore, you could stop by at Indonesia. And then this is also our traditional clothes, batik. That you are wearing in this picture. So hopefully one day we could give you the batik directly, and then also you could take up this picture. So thank you so much for sharing your wisdom with the scientific communities in Indonesia. We truly thank you from the bottom of our heart, and we will have this picture frame sent to your address. Thank you so much, Roy. Okay, so I would like to end today's talk by thanking Roy once again, and also to invite everyone to please spread out the news about ForMind Institute, like our YouTube channel, and also don't forget to follow our Instagram account so that you don't miss informations on our events and updates. And I would like to remind you also that next week we will have the talk on academia industry partnership from Professor Susumu Uchiyama of Osaka University and Dr. Julius Tiadi from the US. He's a researcher from the industry. And also for session 6, we will have the Ritu Sasina, Astellas Pharma Associate Director of Analysis, and also the Managing Director of the biggest funder for startups in Indonesia, science and technology-based startups. So, please stay tuned, and I would like to thank you so much once again to all of the participants who stayed with us until the very end. I thank our speakers, and thank you once more for joining our event. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Thank you so much, everyone.
Thank you.
Hopefully you will get published and sing We Are the Champion soon.
Oh ya,
always. Ya, sampai ketemu semuanya. Terima kasih banyak.
Terima kasih. Terima kasih, Bu Sastia.
Terima kasih.